You are watching ACC Men's Soccer on the ACC Network. It's not often the number one team in the country comes to town. That is the case today as the Louisville Cards host the Pitt Panthers in this ACC midseason matchup. Delighted to have you with us pitch side on a gorgeous Friday afternoon. Matt Schumacher alongside Jeff Greer. And Jeff, it's a weird season, right? Everyone's
yes.
just been playing conference opponents, but we do have the top five teams in the country ranked. Four of those five come from the ACC.
Like you said, weird season as a small litter to pick from, but Pitt is scoring a ton of goals, and the result obviously is the best start in program history.
First time they've ever been ranked number one in the history of the program. Jay Vidovich has his club playing very well. Big reason why is the man up top, Marturo Ordonez, and Valentin Noel, who's coming off a pair of goals in an upset win over Virginia.
As a Frenchman, all freshman in the ACC last season, just an electric player with the ball at his feet. He's always looking to make something happen.
Pedro Fonseca, likewise on the other side, leading the Cards this year with three goals. He's had a fantastic start to his campaign after dealing with injury in 2019. Fun matchup around the corner. Pitt has never beat Louisville. The Cards are 5-0 all time against the Panthers. Will that change today? We find out just around the corner. Kickoff coming up next from the Derby City. Kickoff just around the corner between the number one ranked Pitt Panthers and the Louisville Cards at Dr. Mark and Cindy Lynn Stadium. Matt Schumacher, Jeff Greer with you. We told you this has been an unprecedented year for Pitt. Jay Vidovich, what a job he has done with this program since coming over in December 2015. And every year, Jeff, they have just continued to raise the standard of Pitt men's soccer. Of course, he comes from a big time pedigree, leading Wake Forest to 13 NCAA tournaments out of 14 seasons.
It's incredible to think about where Pitt has come from with him at the helm. You talk about a team that was 4-50-8 against conference opponents in the 6 years leading up to them hiring him. And he has just completely turned this program. He called him a sleeping giant.
Players taking a knee to start, something that all teams in the ACC have done to begin the season, but particularly this week. It is ACC Unity Week, developed through the efforts of the ACC's Committee for Racial and Social Justice. Players wearing Unite wristbands as well, produced by the ACC in an effort to promote Unity Week across the conference. The man in the middle is Veljko Petković, and he has us underway from Louisville. Well, these two teams squared off in the preseason, and Pitt won 5-0. Now, that score a bit deceiving because Louisville didn't have its full complement of players, but Jeff, what are your keys to the game for the Pitt Panthers here in round two?
Well, first of all, if they can jump on it early on, they can kind of squash any attempt at an upset. I know Louisville's a high quality team, so it's not exactly David versus Goliath here, but get some early intensity going. The other thing is that French connection. We talked about Valentin Noel, Bertin Jackson as well. They've got some really talented international players. Mm. Get them the ball at their feet and let them go to work.
Louisville here trying to connect in the midfield. Cards are coming off a couple of really good performances. The result against Virginia would lead you to believe that they didn't play as well as they thought they should have. But actually, John Michael Hayden feels like his team played the best they have all season against Virginia. What are your keys for the Cards against the Panthers today?
Well, first and foremost, Pittsburgh has been so deadly on set pieces. Louisville obviously is going to expect to defend quite a bit, so they've got to be safe, clear the ball away on those set pieces. And we talked about Fonseca. Get him in space and let him pick out passes, dribble a little bit, take on defenders, and that's where I think they can spring forward and get some of those goals. But I think above all else, Matt, is both of these teams keep playing overtime games. So it seems like at some point something's got to give. But if not, maybe we may be headed for another one today.
Oh, boy, you're already putting that on us 2 minutes into the first half.
It's still early. It's still early. So
I'm sorry, folks at home. First set piece opportunity of the contest. You kind of talked about that just a moment ago. Louisville defending set pieces. And John Michael Hayden emphasized to us in the pregame call earlier this week, they have got to be organized defensively. And right into the midst of Jake Kelnovac. Now, some of the Pitt players thought that Kelnovac caught it behind the line, but nothing from the referee, and we play on.
A little bit of a dangerous catch there for Kelnovac, and he's kind of letting it come to him instead of meeting it with his hands there, but it's a hard call to make when you don't have that goal line technology like they do in the Premier League.
Kelnovac back in the lineup after he had to sit out their last match against Syracuse after he was given a red card at the end of the match against Virginia. And Jack Fasteen as well, number 8 on the bottom of your screen, he sat out with a red card last time out as well. Been an eventful couple of games for the Louisville Cards.
Yeah, 3 red cards. They've already conceded 4 penalties, 3 of them converted. I mean, it's been a wild season, but it's perfect considering how wild this entire year has been. It's fitting that it's gone that way for the Cardinals.
I asked John Michael Hayden, I said, Coach, how would you describe the last 2 games? And he said, well, it's 2020.
It's the simplest way to explain it. There's no other easier way to do it.
Pitt really likes the pressure with their forwards and midfielders. And thus, John Michael Hayden talking about staying organized at the back. There he is in his 2nd season as the head coach. 6th season with the program overall. He's been part of a winning tradition and culture here at the University of Louisville, and feels like his club is really bought in this season to the identity of the team.
We talked a lot about that effort this season.
Fonseca, the first shot of the afternoon for Louisville, and our first look at Nico Campuzano, the grad transfer from Portland University, in net for Pitt.
Yeah, this Louisville team are losing so much from last season. I know when we called the Notre Dame game earlier this year, we were talking about just how much of a transition it is. So for John Michael Hayden to be thinking that this team is making that transition, that adjustment, is a big, big plus for them. And then you look at the schedule that they're playing, and they've got to learn quickly with a young team and an inexperienced team trying to fill a lot of key roles.
Here's Ordonez. We talked about in the open, had a game-winning goal against Virginia. It was a header on a beautiful ball in from the corner in overtime. Big time win against the top 5 ranked Virginia team. And that win really catapulted the Pitt Panthers into the top 5 and ultimately into the top spot.
It's incredible for Pittsburgh, the first time for an athletics program or team in their athletics program to be number 1 in the country since 2009, when they had an absolutely electric basketball team. Dwan Blair, super physical, made number 1 in February of 2009, back in the old beastly Big East. Louisville and Pittsburgh both very familiar with those old days, so forgive me for feeling like this is a Big East matchup, even if it's not still in the Big
East.
You're
dating yourself, Jeff.
I know. The new ACC. It's exciting to see all the same or so many familiar faces in the ACC to add that extra punch, and this league is just so, so talented. can already see that for Louisville, they're trying really hard to keep bodies behind the ball because Pittsburgh is just so capable of playing out in space, and they want to spread you out and go right at you. And when Louisville does keep those blocks, they keep their shape and defend, not only do they feel a little bit more confident in that realm, but it also really helps them spring ahead with a counterattack. We talked about Fonseca getting the ball at his feet, but it just really feels a lot better for Louisville when they're playing with confidence and cohesion defensively.
Played back by Lamin Conti. Look at how high the lines are for Pitt. And even when defending, they've got their back line up near midfield.
Yeah, they basically want to just play in the other team's half. and you know, that is, it's always an interesting type of a chess match for teams playing against them, because you've got to try to unlock that defense, whether it's through good through balls and guys who know how to run into space and pick apart back lines, or if you're playing long balls way out high in behind where those fullbacks have extended up the field as Pitt does. But you've just got to be careful you don't throw too many bodies forward, because they can spring an attack on you like nothing.
Here's something over the top for Valentin Noel and a little too much behind it. But a corner kick coming for the Pitt Panthers, and this is where they have been so dangerous this year. Arturo Ordonez won the game on a corner kick, heading it in against Virginia last week, catapulting Pitt into the top spot. And now here's Petkovic. Low ball in and through, and the first goal of the game has been counted or waved off? Yes, it has been counted, and the Pitt Panthers are on the board first.
Credit Bryce Washington, 6'2" target, comes screaming in. Former Big Ten all-freshman transfer from Rutgers, and let's watch this free kick here. The left foot of Petkovic comes in, dangerous area in the 6-yard box, and I think Louisville just did exactly what we were talking about in the keys to the game. They've got to be the first to the ball. You can't let that thing come down in that area and expect to comfortably defend it. You're asking a lot of your goalkeeper, and that's a really tough goal to give up early on in this game, when I'm sure Louisville spent a lot of time this week talking about set pieces.
First goal of the season for Washington, the second year transfer from Rutgers. That was just a wacky way for the ball to go in. Felt like nobody really knew exactly where the ball was. And then all of a sudden it's whipped in by Washington, and a one goal lead for Pitt now. How does Louisville respond?
Those types of balls, you want your defenders or your goalkeeper to come out and claim them, to basically say, that's my ball, and don't allow the attacker to meet it. And that's what I was saying, is the ball coming down on that trajectory, at that point you're putting yourself already in a dangerous spot defensively to try to keep them out. Pitt just keeps on scoring, that they're scoring so many goals so far this season.
Scored 5 against Louisville in the exhibition game during the preseason and the build up to this 2020 campaign. But you're right, Pitt's gone out over the last couple of years and recruited some very good goal scorers, and that's paid off here in 2020.
Talking about the international flavor of the roster, it's great to see. You got a player from Switzerland, a couple French guys, a couple Serbians, a couple Spaniards. It's pretty cool.
Well represented.
Absolutely. And I'm sure it's fun to be on a team like that, because you can learn so much from each other, from being from all sorts of different places.
And there's a confluence of styles as well, right? Because every country has a little bit different flavor of how they play.
Absolutely.
How they come up in whatever it is, club setups or academy systems.
It is interesting that the game is coming to meet the American style, which is a little bit more physical version of what the Germans preach, which is a lot more pace and speed.
Talking about pace, here is Elijah Amo trying to get that goal back. Pitt Panthers scoring over three goals a game. Leaves it off. Now it comes across the box and over the top from Pedro Fonseca. Good look for the Louisville Cards.
It's a really nice find, too, to hold the ball up and wait. Sometimes they get the itch once you're in the box to try to turn and have a rip as quickly as the ball is at your feet. But a nice chance there for Louisville, and I'm sure Fonseca, based on that reaction, will be regretting and thinking about that one for a little bit.
3.25 goals per game for Pitt through the first four games of the regular season.
It's pretty good.
Yes, that is that's tough to keep pace with. I don't care how good your attack is. And it puts a lot of pressure on your back line as well.
Absolutely. And they have not defended probably as well as they would like. They have conceded. They've got the high line there. But I do think that when you play the way that they play, you kind of come into the game saying, look, we might give up a goal. We might give up two goals. But we also know that we can score two if you score one, and we could score three if you score two. And that ability to carve out those late goals, they've done it time and time again this season already, has to give you so much more confidence when teams are putting the pressure on you to know that you can return the favor.
High lines now for Louisville, which they did play with against Pitt in that match where they gave up five goals. Now, they didn't have the full complement of players, and they were playing in a bit of a more aggressive formation than John Michael Hayden would typically. But now down a goal early and trying to find the equalizer here in the first half. Yeah, Louisville has never lost to Pitt. 5-0 all time since these clubs started getting together. And all-time scoring, even after that Pitt goal, 14-3.
Pretty lopsided.
Pretty lopsided. But again, it goes back to the rapid growth that we've seen from this Pitt Panthers men's soccer program under the tutelage of Jay Vidovich. It's been a meteoric rise. Here's a ball into the area and played easily by Campuzano.
Well, I got to give credit to my old friend Craig Meyer at the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette, who wrote a story about this Pitt men's soccer team and included a 42-game winless streak before Vidovich arrived.
Remarkable. But now they've won multiple games in the ACC tournament each of the last couple of seasons, and they got their first NCAA tournament win rather last year.
And I think if they win today, they match their ACC win total from all of last season, and they'll have only played a third of the same number of matches as last year. So pretty impressive start already for them this season, and you just can tell that this feels like the culmination of the work that they've been doing to build up to this level of a team.
Albeit in a rather unusual 2020 season, the first time the Pitt Panthers have ever been ranked number one in the country in men's soccer. 15 minutes down, what are your impressions so far?
Well, they got the early goal, which put Louisville in a pinch a little bit, because you've got to be careful throwing bodies forward against such a high-pressing, high-paced team like Pitt. You don't want to get your numbers out of whack defensively, but you've got to figure out a way to carve out a goal, and I think that they did a nice job on the one counterattack where they eventually found Fonseca with a good shot at goal, but they've just got to continue to stay in possession here and see if they can probe a little bit and find ways to get the ball at his feet and see if he can be the creator for them. One thing we do know, Matt, is Louisville's not going to be afraid. I mean, this is just knockdown, drag-out conference soccer. The quality of team that these teams are playing night in and night out just makes it so that you probably don't feel as rattled down 1-0 as you might if you were playing a 20-game season instead of a 10-game season.
Yeah, where every game matters just a little bit more. You take a look at goals against versus goals scored, and lopsided, to say the least. Not the right ratio that John Michael Hayden and his side want to see. However, they are playing better as of late. They're coming off a 2-2 draw against Syracuse, scoring two goals with a man down, and they scored those two goals in the 77th minute and then again in the 80th minute. And so John Michael Hayden really loves the fight that he has seen in his team, and they've dealt with so much this year. Health, injury, players having to sit out for a game or two, have not always had the full complementary roster.
Well, I think it tells you a lot about your team when they're able to scratch and claw and get goals like that. And as we've said, I mean, to play the level of opponent that they're playing with, a lot of replace guys who have had to come in and replace key players for them who've moved on after last season, you would think that you would take a lot of beatings, and instead they're feeling like they're being very competitive in a very, very, very tough league.
Another opportunity for Petkovic here, lining up the corner kick. Rain starting to fall here in Louisville. There's the corner from Petkovic into the area again. This game was supposed to kick off at 7 p.m. tonight. They bumped it up to 1, so a 6-hour difference to try and beat the storms coming into the lower Midwest. Surely that has to affect the men on the pitch, particularly early in the game, because we didn't get that notification of the game change until yesterday.
Yeah, you got to wake up a little bit earlier. You got to start your game process a little bit earlier. And I guarantee you, these guys, all of them who have been playing high levels of competitive soccer for better part of a decade at this point, once you're in college, they've got their routines down, and to have to shift it late like they have certainly is a challenge, but that's why you rise to the level that they have risen to in Division I soccer. You should be able to adjust a little bit better than guys like us who, I don't know, pull our muscles golfing like I did the other day. I'm struggling with the strained back here. That's not what these guys are having to deal with, waking up a little bit earlier in the day. I will say, Matt, it doesn't seem like Pitt is as flowing and confident right now on the ball as we know they're capable of. I don't know if that's necessarily Louisville doing a much better job of being disruptive or just staying in possession, but Pittsburgh has not been able to put together as many sort of free-flowing, hard-hitting attacks that we're used to seeing in the early stages of games. And they still have a goal, which I'm sure, knowing all of that previous information, they'll be happy to already be up 1-0.
Yeah, this game doesn't really seem to have had much of a flow to it whatsoever. Mm-hmm. It's been a lot of exchanging of possession. Pitt finding the back of the net on a loose ball off a corner kick at the start of this match. If you're just joining us, they scored in the first 10 minutes of the match. Louisville really haven't had many opportunities to respond, minus one shot that went over the top bar by Pedro Fonseca. Fastine on the near side, trying to connect. Here's Loffelson for Pitt.
You just wonder if the rain coming down now just changes a little bit for everyone too. Maybe the grass is a little bit slower, the ball doesn't move as quickly. It's a lot harder to make the runs that you can make when it's dry out. It's a beautiful ball there though.
Switching fields, attack coming in, headed away, and done nicely by Haji Abdelkadir.
If the team you're playing is settled in a little bit into their blocks and they're dropping lower, something like that is a great way to unlock them. Play something diagonal, see if you can switch fields and get one of your playmakers on the ball.
Dexter on the turnover, tipped away by Conti, still alive in the area for Pitt. Walty now. Petkovic on the edge. And Conti watches it roll out of play, and a goal kick coming for Galnavac. Good string of passes there for Pitt in the offensive third.
You can see the gears working a little bit more in the last minute or two. You saw the switching of the fields, trying to get a little 1-2 play. And that's something that Louisville is certainly going to be alert to, because we know those Pittsburgh players coming in off the flanks, their attackers are just so fast. They want to get into space. They want to have the chance to take defenders on. So you've got to make sure you've got bodies back, and not just bodies clogging passing lanes, but guys who are alert and can be disruptive defensively.
It's been a significant jumbling of the roster and personnel in certain positions for John Michael Hayden this year. Haji Abdelkadir, perfect example, who we've seen a couple of times already this afternoon, playing in the right back position. He came to Louisville as a midfielder, and that is not uncommon on their roster this year.
Yeah, and Lamine Conti, a midfielder, central midfielder, dropping into a defensive role. I mean, it's just they've had to make a lot of changes to their team. Emil Elveroth, typically a center forward, has been at times dropping off on the flanks, although he's central now. And I think that's one, a sign of having versatile players, but two, you're having to make a big transition with this roster.
There is Loffelson coming up from the right back position. Across the mouth of goal, nobody home. And a foul anyway. Nick Balser, our central referee this afternoon, calling it on the Panthers. Cards lost 5 starters from last season. 10 players overall, though, from the 2019 squad. And that was a talented team. Of course, they made a run into the NCAA tournament. And they lost a lot of goal scorers. Kino Ryosuke being one of them, who came off the bench. A lot of personnel replacements happening in 2020.
It was 20 of their 27 goals from last year are now gone, at least the guys who scored them. That's
Sharif,
a big challenge.
Jay, too, who's now playing in the USL.
It's a big, big challenge to replace that. And both of these programs obviously recruit well. Long history with Louisville and Pittsburgh rising back to where it expects to be. And they've got those goal scorers and attacking players. It's just a matter of cultivating them into shape and working it out. Pittsburgh obviously is a little bit further ahead in that process, but Louisville has that chance too with the talent they've got.
What would you like to see from Louisville here to get something going and create chances in the offensive third?
At this point, you got to be a little bit less predictable. Try something different, try a diagonal ball, try maybe playing over the top. I think that's the one thing with a high line is maybe you can get your speed guys out on the flanks, out into space, and let them chase a ball down versus having a breakdown Pittsburgh, which is going to be a frenetic defensive team through passes on the ground. But they just haven't really been able to unsettle Pittsburgh when Louisville's in possession. It's a little too slow and not direct enough for my liking at this point.
Fastine off the mark. And a turnover to Pitt. Pitt Panthers this year have wins over a couple of top five programs. Notre Dame at the time, Virginia most recently, plus victories against Virginia Tech and Syracuse. 4-0 coming into the match against Louisville this afternoon.
And even crazier for me, 54 years. Their first, NCAA tournament appearance in a really, really, really long time. And now they look obviously like a lock to get back to the postseason, be a dominant team. So a nice little run here. And it feels like, as we said earlier, it's kind of come to a head. They've just got so many different talented players, guys who have grown into roles, a couple transfers, as you mentioned, Matt. And it's a nice roster that they've put together for this season.
First NCAA tournament appearance since 1965.
It's a long time ago.
Yes. Before we landed on the moon.
I was going to say LBJ is president. Let's think of our 1965.
Oh, no, please don't do that
facts.
To me. You'll have me beat in every category in that regard. Nick Balser having none of that. Pedro Fonseca thought for sure he was fouled, but instead a restart for the Panthers coming.
Louisville's got to find a way to have Fonseca get the ball at his feet. And he's just so dangerous in space. He's so good taking defenders on. We saw that against Notre Dame, against high-quality opponents. We know that he can take those guys on. He's got good vision, obviously has a goal-scoring touch. But they have not been able to figure out a way to get the ball regularly at his feet to see if he can unlock this Pittsburgh defense.
I wonder, too, if they can get Emil Alvaroth going as well. That combination of Fonseca and Alvaroth. And then Elijah Amo on the flank adds that ability to sort of stretch the defense with his pace. But we haven't seen any of that today because they've been so locked down by the Panthers.
And when they're in possession, Louisville has been a little too patient. I think they've got to be a little bit more deliberate with what they're doing because they're just swinging it side to side, not really threatening to get out of their own area really.
Nearly 30 minutes gone in the first half, a 1-0 lead for Pittsburgh. And the first sub of the afternoon, Nico Diaz coming on, the freshman from Florida.
Big time scorer coming up through Inter Miami and Orlando SC Academy. Really, really talented player, and you can see that why they like him because of that, and they've got to try to see if they can get the ball at his feet as well in attacking positions. But again, it's just kind of locked in defensively for Louisville right now, and they just haven't really been able to get anybody out in space to do any damage on Pittsburgh's defense.
Diaz, a tremendous goal scorer at the prep level. Tallied 44 goals and 65 starts for Orlando City SC's U19 Academy. Ordonez. Petkovic fighting for it with Bradley Sample. Sanchez giving it off now. Here comes Pedro Fonseca. And nobody home in the midfield when it was played back.
That's the issue with Louisville's counterattackers, waiting to see what would develop there, but they don't get enough bodies forward. And that's the problem, because they know that they have to defend all of these talented attackers for Pittsburgh, that they're kind of staying back. And the result is Pittsburgh is scurrying back to defend the counter with enough bodies. And Louisville only really had two or three guys that were passing lane options in the attack. And so that is going to be something certainly that they'll talk about at halftime and try to adjust a little bit. I don't know what the solution is right now, but they're just not getting those bodies forward quickly enough when there's a chance to spring that counterattack.
Takedown in the midfield. Carlos Sanchez tacked with the foul. It's Loffelson down, rolling and grabbing his right thigh.
Really, really good player, Loffelson. For assists already this season. Grew up in that western corner, northwestern corner of Germany. Really talented young player. And very, very dangerous coming in off the flank. We've already seen him. He started out on the right-hand side and has been coming into the middle of the pitch a little bit more. And yeah, I mean, I think that's going to hurt a little bit. I don't know that that's a yellow card necessarily, but it is a clear foul and good way to feel it a little bit. I'm sure he'll be thinking about that foul tomorrow when he's rubbing his side.
Hit the ice sub after the match today. 12 minutes and change left of the first half. Louisville really has only had one great chance to speak of. Pedro Fonseca on a ball across the mouth of goal, putting it just a tad above the top bar. And if you're just joining us, Pitt scoring early. It was about 10 minutes into the first half on a corner kick. Bryce Washington on a loose ball, kicking it into the back of the net, and a 1-0 lead for Pitt. They have never beat the University of Louisville in men's soccer. But they are a little over a half away from adding another first in the 2020 campaign. It's hard to believe they've only played five times, given the fact that they did play in the Big East together for some time. Now they've played in the ACC together for the last handful of seasons. Both really big conferences, though, with separate divisions.
Mm-hmm.
So they didn't get a chance to
factor.
Yeah, they didn't get a chance to play each other every season.
Well, and Pitt has been in such an interesting position. Joe Luxbacher, of course, the longtime coach there, there forever, seemingly, but they just never really crossed paths a whole lot. And when they did, Louisville dominated.
Louisville leads the all-time scoring 14-3, even after that goal from Pitt to start the first half. And now a foul on Sanchez. He's got to be careful. He's been whistled for a foul a couple of times here in the first half. And a free kick coming in an area of opportunity for the Panthers.
I'll be interested to see here if this is a left-footed shot for Pekovic. Maybe it's an awkward angle for him, but an opportunity to whip across in, whatever it is. But they are, Pitt's really trying to get the ball out to that left flank to Alexander Dexter to do something with it, and he earned that foul.
Whipped in back post and hit it over the top bar. It was a lovely opportunity for Valentin Noel on the receiving end of that free kick.
Just moved Louisville's defense just a little bit with the first touch there, but then could whip that cross into the back post. There were two white shirts there. We'll see here on this replay. Two white shirts at that back post. Noel, that's a tight angle, but man, unmarked at the back post, and Louisville has to do a better job of being physical and warding off Pitt's attackers on the back post on set piece opportunities.
The defense, they've really struggled with that organization piece this year. And it's something that John Michael Hayden said was a must in this match against Pitt today. A Abubakar Kamara trying to track it down. He could not, but a corner kick coming, and now an opportunity potentially for Louisville. It'll be their first set piece of the afternoon.
This is one way to break the run of play. Set piece is the great equalizer, a great way to score goals. We know Louisville has scored quite a few of them this year off set pieces, so this is a great opportunity as the half is winding down to get a little momentum in your set, into your sails.
The kick for Louisville, number 4, Haji Abdikadir. Haji Abdikadir on the corner. Jack Fastine hanging tight to him. And a whistle blown by Balser, our central referee, and a red card has been shown. And it's been shown to Abubakar Kamara. My goodness. The third match in a row that Louisville now has had a player sent off.
And I've got to see the replay here, but the referee immediately went to the red, so I'm guessing he felt like he had a pretty clear view of it right away, and that's just something that it's a mistake you just can't make. Let's see the replay here. Kamara with a shove. Oh, he got the headbutt. Yep, that's a clear red and pretty easy call for the referee, especially when he had the clear view of it there. And you just know on set pieces there's going to be jostling. You've got to be able to deal with the physicality of it without lashing out like that. That's, I'm sure, very frustrating for John Michael Hayden.
So now Louisville will play a man down for the remainder of the match. And you would think then that a set piece like this becomes even more important to break up the run of play. John Michael Hayden wanted an explanation here. And Nick Balser will go to the video replay.
Potentially a very damaging situation here for Louisville, an incident that they already were struggling to defend against Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh hasn't looked as cohesive as they have in previous matches. And you just kind of assume that at some point a team that has scored multiple goals in every game that they've played is going to get it together a little bit more. And you need everybody that you can get on the field to help you defend, help you clog up the midfield, set your low blocks, and really make your team tough to break down. And that's why in those situations you've got to stay calm and avoid situations exactly like this. Puts your team in a tight situation.
So as Nick Balser trots back out onto the pitch, he has waved to the Louisville sideline to bring the players back on. Kamara, the red card, third match in a row the Louisville has had at least one player sent off, and now they are down to 10 men for the remainder of this match. They'll play the next nearly 55 minutes with a man down against a pit side that has been super aggressive and one of the highest scoring teams in the country this year, 3.25 goals per game.
Now set pieces become a really critical aspect of you trying to equalize and get back into this game. If you're Louisville, you've got to take advantage of those situations. Don't know how many more you'll be able to get. So when you take these corners, you've got to beat the first man, you've got to beat the near post and find a red shirt.
Abdikadir. Headed away. Played back in by Festine, but the whistle's been blown and it's back to the Panthers.
Ball just not quite played into a dangerous enough area. It was near post. Pretty simple clearance. Of course, Louisville looked like they might have a chance to get a shot back in on goal there before the foul, but if you're when you're in these set piece situations, you've got to clear that first man into the box and put it in an area where your team can get a limb to it, get a leg to it, a head to it, a shoulder to it, whatever it is in those scramble situations.
Markovic, a good ball over the top, and it's going out for a goal kick. You know, Louisville was down 2-0 against Syracuse the last time out. They were also down to 10 men, and yet they found a way to score not one but two goals to equalize. John Michael Hayden scribbling in his black book there, trying to figure out strategy. Against Syracuse, they switched the formation and went to a 3-2-1-3. And you wonder if that's an option against a Pitt team that continues to pepper the net. Here's another opportunity. Turnover and just left wide by Petkovic, but it's been tipped out and a corner kick coming.
That's the challenge, is the way Pitt is playing, the way they flood guys forward, typically once the ball has been played to that front line of attack, I think they've got four guys forward already. It might make it a little bit more difficult to play for Louisville to play that way.
Severe area in the weather, so fans are heading for coverage, but they are allowing the players to continue these final 6.5 minutes or so in the first half.
This is exactly what we had been hoping to avoid
right,
by moving the
right.
game up.
The severe
it's
weather in the area. Game was meant to start at 7 p.m. tonight. Bumped it up to a 1 p.m. kickoff. First half nearly complete. Pitt on top 1-0, scoring early in the first half on a corner kick that found the foot of Bryce Washington. Markovic. There's Jackson Walty. Pitt very patient and composed in the offensive third. There's a ball in and it's tipped out of play and a corner kick coming again for the men in white.
But that's what Crivillo and Luffelsen make, that's why they make it so difficult for Louisville to switch to that back three, is those fullbacks are way, way up for Pitt and can overwhelm you on the flanks.
Bertine Jackson on the corner, bending it in, tipped away by Gelnavach. Couldn't quite get the mitts on it, and so it'll be a corner from the other side now.
It's not fun to be a goalkeeper in this weather.
No, perhaps some slick mitts as the rain has continued to fall throughout the first half. Dangerous situation for the Cards. You don't want to go down 2-0 right before the half with only 10 men to play with the rest of the way. Back post again, and it's headed over the top bar. Good look for Rafael Crivello. The Pittsburgh's had a couple of really nice opportunities here on the back end of these first 45 minutes.
Starting to look a little bit more confident going forward, and that's where it just becomes so difficult when you're down to 10 men, is obviously first and foremost, you've got to make sure you've got enough people back to defend. And then against a team that is so good on set pieces, that just adds another element of danger when you're already trying to come back from a deficit.
Walty turning it back into the midfield. Fonseca wrestling it away. Now Louisville trying to commit numbers forward. Here is Diaz. And now Festine has to play it all the way back. Pressure mounting for Pitt. Conti turning it over. And now numbers for the Panthers. The shot deflected in, and it's a 2-goal lead for Pitt. Off the foot of Philip Markovic. 2-0 Pitt Panthers.
Well, that's where the pressure for Pittsburgh comes into play. They know they're a man up. They know they can really harry whoever has the ball. And that's exactly what happened. Conti did not have anywhere to go with it. You could see he was trying to figure out where to play that ball, and it is wet. And
rocket
that is a
shot.
Heck of a hit from Mirkovic. The Belgrade native came up through the New York City Football Club program, the academy, and just ripped that. There's not a whole lot you can do if you're Jake Geldebash.
And so now Louisville finds themselves in the same position they were in earlier against Syracuse the last time out. Down to 10 men and down 2-0. Coaches and officials getting together to discuss the situation on the pitch regarding weather. The fans have already left the stadium. Nick Balser, the central referee, discussing with John Michael Hayden and Jay Vidovich. Game was already moved up 6 hours today. The start time was supposed to be 7 p.m. tonight. They started it at 1 p.m. They're now dealing with more stoppage of play due to inclement weather in the area. Doesn't look all that bad on your screen, but around the city of Louisville, that's where the issue is right now with weather coming in from across the country. Still haven't gotten used to watching ACC soccer without a single fan in the stands.
Yeah, that's an adjustment for sure, and especially not being able to have a home field advantage in a game like this. You'd think you're going to be playing Friday night against the number one team in the country. You would think that they would get a nice student presence at this game. They'd be able to make some noise, and maybe the energy runs through your team a little bit differently. Instead, we're dealing with weather delays and rain, and now you got the red card. It's just a totally different script than maybe an alternate universe would have written for Louisville soccer.
So the teams will go to the halftime locker room. They will finish these 3:45 after the break and then continue with the final 45 after that. It's a 2-0 lead for the Pitt Panthers. Louisville down to 10 men after they've had a man sent off for the third consecutive match. Tall task ahead against the number one team in the country. Pitt 2, Louisville 0.
Ken. So I was always a kid growing up playing soccer and enjoyed just playing the game. Didn't really take it super seriously until I got to U of L, and like, he always drove home with individual players and as a team, like, you can't take days off, or you can't take it for granted, because the minute you take your foot off the pedal, there's going to be an opportunity to be beaten.
You know, I think we actually lost the game in preseason to Penn State. And that was probably the best thing that happened to us, because then we realized we weren't invincible. The combination of that loss against Penn State and that tie against Duke just kind of fueled, like, we can't make any mistakes. So that was the biggest thing Ken would promote to us, is do not get complacent and train every day like it's, you know, we're playing for the national championship the next day.
I think what you realized is that this was a team that, despite their incredible record, didn't really have, I think, maybe just one, what you would label as a lopsided win. And so it was a team that had to earn every win. But I think what you saw is a team that was mentally tough. And I think it reflected, you know, Ken's philosophy. And Ken was always great at appreciating the process and not always dwelling on the result.
There would always be, like I said, you know, someone that would either impact the game coming in, or, you know, finding ways to just keep grinding and grinding teams down until we find the opportunity. I'm sure there were a lot of games that we went into and we struggled and somehow found a way to win. And I think that's just persistence.
once you get one, you know, that feels good. So that's some confidence. You get another one, it's like, wow, okay. You know, it just, and it continues to progress. And then you got three or four of those under your belt, and it's just like, it does not matter. We're not going to get rattled. We keep working and we can get the job done. I'm not kidding. This feeling with the team sport does not come around all the time. It's very, very rare. And it's a special, special feeling to have.
I think just every game, no matter what the scenario, no matter what the game was, we would always end up finding a way to just get it done, get the win. Just knowing that even going into any game, I was like, yeah, it doesn't matter what the situation is, what the team is, we're going to figure a way. So one of the guys that we have is going to step up and make plays.
So I think the combination of some veteran players having been there before, the combination of that and the mental attitude that we're not going to lose. We were going to win. It was just a matter of how and when.
It had to be like 7-8 games in. And I remember going with Avi, who's my roommate at the time. We looked at the schedule and I was like, bro, I think we might go undefeated. Like, our team is legit. Like, we're sweet. Like, we have a real good chance of going undefeated. And I remember that moment in great detail, telling him, like, hey, bro, I think we might go all the way. Like, it's really possible.
And I think in that year, just because we had so many experienced guys and that had played in some big games before and been around, it was, okay, hey, like, this is the time. You know, we're used to this now, but this is what we wanted. And definitely gave other teams, especially in the Big East at that time, a little extra push to want to beat the number one team.
Yeah, the first time of being ranked number one at the University of Louisville was special, and it was unique, and we recognized it. We didn't back away from it. We recognized the achievement for what it was, but we also understood that being number one in October didn't mean anything. It was December that we were concerned about.
Welcome back to Louisville. Players back on the pitch. It's a 2-0 lead for the Pitt Panthers. We had a weather delay, and as you can see, it's cleared up a little bit. Just enough, Jeff Greer, for us to sneak in the remainder of the first half, which is 3:45. Take a quick break and hopefully get in the final 45.
Yeah, and the players, you can see he's still stretching, trying to get warm again after having to take a long break. The weather messing with their mojo here, but I'm gonna try to get this one in.
Filip Mirkovic giving the Pitt Panthers a 2-goal lead on an absolute screamer, which you'll get another look at later on in the broadcast. For those who are just joining us, Pitt scored early in the first half on a corner kick that was deflected off of a Louisville player, Bradley Sample. Wrong place, wrong time, 1-0. Louisville then had a red card. Abubakar Kamara getting sent off, rather. And then another goal for Pitt, making it 2-0.
It's been, it was a weird match before the weather delay. It was kind of cagey. Pitt really didn't feel like it was playing the way it's capable of getting forward. Obviously, they still got the two goals, but didn't look extremely smooth getting forward. Louisville pinned back a little bit defensively, but the red card really put Louisville in a tough, tough spot. You're already defending a lot, and then to lose a man, you're down 2-0 now. You've had all these breaks. You just got to figure out a way to get through this, maybe win a couple set pieces and see if you can flip the script a little bit after such a weird first entree into this game.
Well, if you remember, last game that Louisville played, they were down to 10 men against Syracuse, trailing 2-0, and they scored two goals to equalize in a span of 3.5 minutes. So it can be done. I would say that Pitt is a tougher opponent to do that against because of how good they are in transition. That is one of their strengths if you talk to Jay Vidovich. But that man right there, John Michael Hayden, not going to go down without a fight.
Right, and it is an interesting group that Louisville has this year. I know we were talking about this in the first half the beginning of the first half, I should say. There's a transitioning team, a lot of guys who were hurt coming back, a lot of younger players, but there's a ton of spirit in this group, and I know that they like the group they have, even if they haven't been getting the results they want.
Threaded through here is Valentin Noel, and it goes off his foot. Boy, he just lost the handle. That could have been dangerous. 3-0 in his sights. 1 minute, 24 seconds left in the first half. Before we came back, we thought this game was going to not count at all because you have to play the first half in order for a match to count in the ACC. And then after looking at the radar for a number of minutes, seemingly an hour, the officials and the coaches decided that there was enough of a window to try and sneak in the remainder of the first half and then a hopeful 45-minute second half.
Really, really clearly that they are just like, hey.
Hanging
let's,
on here.
Yeah, let's hustle through this, see if we can get it. We'll have a brief halftime, like you said, and see how it goes.
Abdelkader plays it down. Diaz outside here to Fonseca. Chipped into the box and played back easily that time by Washington. Diaz scrambling to get the ball thrown in. Louisville, a rare moment here of multiple possessions in the offensive third. Kicked in by Diaz and into the midst of Campuzano. And that will round out the conclusion of the first half. There will be a very brief halftime break. And we'll be back to kick it off for half number two next. Welcome back to the University of Louisville after a brief break. Bad weather in the area caused a slight delay. Here's a recap of what happened in the first half. A corner kick banged in off of Bradley Sample by way of Bryce Washington. Then later, Abubakar Kamara, red card sent off for a headbutt. Then Mirkovic, bang! Absolute rocket shot to make it 2-0. The referees bring the players and the coaches together because of inclement weather in the area. The players unsure of why they're headed to the locker rooms, but nonetheless, they spent the last hour in the locker room, came back out, finished the remainder of the first half, which was 3:45. And now, Jeff Greer, here we are for the final 45 minutes.
If you were able to follow all of that, I commend you. A lot of fun in the first half. It was an awkward half, really, for both teams, but the sign of Pittsburgh being one of the better teams in the country this year is that they're able to kind of scratch and claw two goals out. Louisville, we know, has experience coming back from 2-0 deficits, playing with 10 men, down a guy, but they've got it all to do, as the British would say here, against a really, really good Pittsburgh team.
And here's a really good run from the pit side. Loffelson, Jasper Loffelson, who is making that run down the right side, a tremendous right back who, in the words of Jay Vidovich, likes to play in the attack, offers a really dynamic personnel option for them on the right side of the defense.
And it does look like Louisville is going to that back three to try to get some bodies available to still try to score goals. I just think, like you said, with Loffelson and a couple of the other guys they have, they want to get width for Pittsburgh and they want to throw a bunch of people forward, and that's got the possibility of overwhelming Louisville and getting more goals, as Louisville is having to commit resources to defending in more ways than they necessarily want to.
Pitt Very composed. Pinpointing passes in the attack. As we talked about moments ago, Louisville did, in their most recent match, erase a 2-0 deficit with a man down against Syracuse. But this Pitt side is very, very good in the attack, and they're particularly good in transition, both offensively and defensively.
Yeah, something that they're really good at, and it's become this newer brand of soccer that's really taken over the game at all levels, is the ability to just be so speedy and disruptive that you can break things up no matter whether you're attacking, counter-pressing, defending, in the midfield, and all those different areas. You can really bother the team you're playing by just being frenetic with your pace and having a lot of athleticism in passing lanes. It's very tough to play against.
Jay Vidovich has this 4-0 Pitt team ranked number one for the first time in program history. Year after year after year, breaking records and rewriting the history books on campus in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
It's crazy to me, Matt, that just three years ago, a winless stretch for Pitt soccer had extended to 42 games. Mm. And 3 years later, they're number one in the country with four consecutive victories to start the season, coming off their first NCAA tournament appearance in 54 years. I mean, that's incredible.
Yeah. And picking up their first ever NCAA tournament win in a victory over Lehigh University. Here's a chip in from Washington. Looking for Jackson Walty. Handled well by Jake Elnovach. Amda Kadir. Threading it to Fonseca. Now switching fields. Louisville starting to commit numbers forward. Two names we have not called much today for Louisville. Emil Alvaroth and Elijah Amo, two players with great pace and scoring ability. Now Pitt again on the attack. And a dangerous moment or two in front of net there before Galinovac could get his mitts on it.
Looked like a moment of hesitation there for Louisville's defense, and luckily Galinovac was the one to kind of take control of the situation, but got to be a little tidier defensively against a Pitt team that is just constantly looking to get on loose balls.
Here's a ball through to Amo. He's a step past the back line. Amo one-on-one, and it's one goal down for Louisville.
Well, just like that, that's what we've been talking about, the ability to crank out goals even when they're down to 10 men, and Louisville showing some life against the run of play there. A beautiful through ball over the top, a missed interception, and Elijah Amo does the rest. Really great ability to carry the ball away from the defenders and tuck it in the back post. Really excellently done there, and a nice goal from him to keep Louisville in this one.
With a player on his hip and using the off foot, no less. Tremendous skill from Elijah Amo. And now you have to wonder, does that change things strategically and tactically for Jay Vidovich?
I still think they're going to just try to play hardcore pressing, get forward, get bodies forward, and try to overwhelm Louisville. We said this at the top of the broadcast. You talk about those high lines, and you adequately, expertly pointed that out there, Matt, that Pitt does play that really high line that leaves you vulnerable to goals like the one we just saw. But the flip side is it also has a bunch of guys forward for you to be able to create things pretty quickly. So I would expect them to keep doing what they're doing and just try to maybe be a little bit more alert getting back on those over-the-top balls. But that may be the recipe for Louisville to try to get back into this thing and get level.
Louisville packing it in now as Mirkovic has it in the midfield. High lines again for Pitt. That's part of what left them exposed on that over-the-top ball to Elijah Amo. Abdelkader dancing through the press, and he draws a foul and a restart coming for the Cards. He is just slick with the ball at his feet.
Yeah, so cool and confident with the ball at his feet. He looked confident the whole time, dribbling around everybody there like he was going to get out of trouble and be able to pick out a pass. Not typically what coaches want, but when you can do it well, they'll let you do it.
Petkovic, now Matt Bailey, and blocked by William Portman. And Portman a bit hobbled after making that extension to block the pass coming across the end line. He's dealt with injury in years past, and Nick Bosser has stopped the clock momentarily as Portman tries to gather himself.
Well, that just shows you, that sequence just shows you what Pittsburgh is capable of doing. They run into space, they pass people open, and they just are so fast getting bodies forward that makes it really tough to defend.
Bertine Jackson, high ball, and missed it on that corner kick opportunity.
Be interesting with no Kamara up front for Louisville with Elveroth and Amo. You can play the thunder and lightning, no pun intended, on today. But with Elveroth, he can be your target man, win the ball, maybe drop a little bit deeper at times and let Amo run off of him. You can see Amo is a little bit further up and see if you can get an opportunity to play him into a seam like the one we just saw. And clearly he likes his chances going 1v1 and in a foot race with the center backs for Pittsburgh. And that may just leave the door open for Louisville to feel like they could get a second goal.
So what's Louisville's strategy here? Sit and counter, try to play a direct ball over the top?
Yeah, it has to be at this point. Maybe try to win some set pieces if you can. But the biggest thing is they've just got to make sure that they are organized at the back, pack it in, make it really difficult for Pittsburgh to find any space to operate.
You just feel that sense of angst maybe for that Louisville back line. Pitt just right on the edge, threatening consistently here. 10 minutes down in the second half, tipped away. Now Fonseca chasing after it, played back in by Crivello. Petkovic, Crivello. Mirkovic, and a foul on Carlos Sanchez. And now a free kick coming for Pitt.
Dangerous area here for Pitt. Might be, no, I think this is shot territory. I was going to say it might be a little too deep for Jackson here, but I think he could have a rip with that right foot. It's just a question of how big is the wall for Gelnavac? What can he read off of this shot here? But a great opportunity.
Maybe 28 yards out here for Bertine Jackson. Jackson has a goal and it's tipped away. Goal kick coming for Gelnavac.
Looked like he opened his hips there. I thought he was going to try to put a little swerve on it, and it just aimlessly went over the bar there. Didn't even really seem like Gelnavac was concerned about it. But I really thought with that right foot that he might be able to whip it into the back post there, but just couldn't get any bend and any dip on it.
Bradley Sample picking it up on the turnover and coughs it up himself. Look at This press from Louisville, a man down. Leaving themselves a bit open on the back end, though. Fonseca gives it up in the midfield, won back by Lamine Conti. Restart coming for Louisville. Now this could be interesting for the Cards. Obviously pretty far out from the mouth of goal. Quickly played back in. Fonseca. A run from Matt Bailey down the left side. Mirkovic plays it wide instead. Low ball in, back heel flip. And Galnovac unable to keep it in the field of play, and a corner kick coming for Pitt.
A lot happening there in that sequence. I think we saw a couple of different things. One, credit to Bradley Sample for the initial pass away. He gave it up, but by counter-pressing as quickly as he did, he allowed Louisville to stay in the attack. But Pitt showing us how dangerous they are in transition, immediately getting from defending to the attacking third. And kind of a shaky attempt at a clearance there to just get a boot on it. And it almost resulted in Galnovac losing sight of that ball there. And kind of bailed out that it went out of bounds.
Petkovic blocked by Fonseca. Pittsburgh scored the first two goals of the match, one very early on. Bryce Washington in the eighth minute. Then Filip Mirkovic had that rocket shot after the red card to Louisville. They were playing a man down to make it 2-0. But Elijah Amo getting Louisville back into the fold with a direct ball over the top from Bradley Sample. And Amo dribbling it in about 20 yards with a man on his hip. And here we are, a 2-1 ball game with just over 30 minutes to play.
Doing a nice job here growing into the midfield a little bit. Obviously their numbers are down, but they have been able to figure out ways to carve out some passes. And if I'm Pittsburgh, I'm not happy about that. I want my midfield with the plus one in this situation to be a little bit more robust and a little bit more disruptive to get the ball back quicker.
Here's William Portman. Miss hit there from the right back. Goal kick coming now for Campuzano.
See Louisville dropping back into that back line five, really. I think when they're in possession, it's a back three with two wing backs, but when they're defending, they just want as many guys behind the ball as possible.
Matt Bailey trying to slip it through. It's interesting. Pitt have had the ball as you might expect, in Louisville's defensive third for much of the second half, and yet they haven't been able to really put anything on goal or test Jake Galinovich whatsoever in the second half.
Yeah, this is a classic drop extremely deep. Get as many people behind the ball as possible and see if you can just absorb as much pressure. Basically, like in American football, dropping all the way back inside your red zone and then really stiffening up there and making it very difficult to break through. And that is one thing that Louisville has done well, is once the ball has entered the 18, they have made it extremely difficult for Pittsburgh to connect that final pass that would open someone up to get a shot away. And that's how you can keep a team out. I don't know how long it's sustainable against a team that is just full of so many attacking players who can finish around the goal like Pitt, but it does give you that chance to keep trying to spring those counterattacks and see if Elijah Amo can strike twice.
Jackson and Petkovic have come out, and perhaps Jay Vidovich going for more defensive-minded players here in the back end of this final half here in Louisville. His team on top 2-1. Without a loss to their name so far this season. Pitt a perfect 4-0. And should they hold on to win here, they would add another first to the record book here in 2020. They have not beat Louisville in five previous meetings. Good pressure here. Louisville struggling to get it out of their own defensive third. Abdelkadir flipping it forward now for Fonseca. Some space to work. Amo turning it back into the midfield. He's got a run down the left side, and he left it too short. Now Louisville have to be careful here. Big run in the box. Valentin Noel heading it into the back of the net. An absolute beauty from Valentin Noel. And it's a 3-1 lead for the Pitt Panthers.
As easy as it's going to get for Valentin Noel there on the back post all by himself. Probably at one point wondering if anybody was coming near him. You see Abdelkadir slipping. Maybe got a little nudge there from Noel, but the perfect ball onto the back post and a simple, simple finish back across the face of the goal. You see it there as fourth of the season. The guy has just been clinical. Three now in the last one-plus games that he's played in, and expertly finished. Galinovich had no chance whatsoever, and that's a real dagger after getting the counterattack goal earlier in this half for Louisville.
Noel coming off a two-goal performance against the University of Virginia, co-offensive player of the week in the ACC. Freshman from Niort, France. Heading to the ridiculous attack that Pitt have had this year. You look at the score, right in line with what Pitt have scored in each of their first four games, right around 3.25 goals per game for the Panthers this season. And tipped over the top bar by Galinovich, and he ran into the post. And a little banged up after he caught his shoulder. You know he's not going to come out. The amount of games that he has played for this Louisville side, he is going to stick this thing out. Pitt have scored more goals today, Jeff Greer, than they have in the previous four games combined. Wow. Against Louisville.
And you can see they're flowing with confidence now. I don't know necessarily that that was an attempt to chip Galinovich, but he had to work it out.
Headed out, Galinovich, goal kick. Well, you knew at some point Pitt was going to have a look at net with the amount of times that they were stringing passes together right around the 18. And it came in a counter opportunity as Louisville was getting aggressive with their lines to try and find that equalizer.
It's already such a challenge when you're playing a team that plays the way Pitt does to know when to spring your counter and when you need to drop deep. But when you're doing it down a guy, it's even worse, especially when you're searching for two goals. I mean, that is a major uphill battle, and they're right back where they started after looking, honestly, like you said, Matt, to have some confidence like they might be able to get that equalizer, but giving up a goal like they did just kind of spooks you a little bit.
Played back for Lafelsund. Pitt still hunting for another goal here. 24 minutes left of the match. Louisville have been playing a man down since the 36th minute. After Abubakar Kamara was sent off for a headbutt in the box, preceding a corner kick for the Cards. Washington. Markovic. Crivillo rolling it forward. He was looking for Bryce Washington. Now Matt Bailey.
And you can see when Pitt is in possession, Louisville is all the way back down, like I said earlier, the five across, and then they've got the three midfielders sitting right in front of them, all about 25 yards or so from goal, if not closer in, with the entire purpose of just making things so condensed that you can't run into space, you can't pass people open very much. The problem with that is that gets you stuck deep and doesn't really allow you to spring the counter, but you can tell why it's so challenging for Louisville, because when they did start to separate a little bit from that low block, they got exposed on a quick counter from Pittsburgh to go back to 3-1. So it's the ultimate challenge for a coach and for his players to try to figure out that right balance. And when you're playing the number one team in the country, it just becomes that much more difficult.
Able to hang on here. They'll improve to 5-0 in the regular season against ACC opponents with two ACC regular season matches left. They head to Notre Dame on Friday, October 30th, and they finish in Pittsburgh against Syracuse on November the 6th. Played Syracuse and Notre Dame once each, picking up wins over both. Here is Bailey trying to dribble it past the back line, unable. Portman coughs it up, and an opportunity again, and that's top nine. Unbelievable shot, and the Pitt Panthers have a 4-1 lead off the foot of Luke Mort.
Well, that's the danger there with trying to play it out of the back on the ground, and you're not super confident with it. Lose the ball in a really, really tough area, and that just, your defense is already into a tough situation there. But Mort, I mean, you're not going to stop that with the best goalkeeper in the world. That is upper 90, almost in off the crossbar. Just a really nice finish from him, and you could see immediately wheeling away in excitement. He knew how good that hit was, and his teammates will be talking about that one for a long time.
Redshirt freshman, first goal of the season. He made his first career start in their last match, which is also his first career appearance in a Pitt uniform. He's having a heck of a 2-week stretch here for the men in white.
It's just so hard when you're down to 10 men and you're defensively constantly under duress. Any mistake, especially again, I know I'm sounding like a broken record, but against such a good attacking team, any misstep within 25 yards of your goal can be lethal. For all the wind that Louisville felt like it had in its sails after that goal, it really honestly felt more like they were likely to get a second for about 5 or 10 more minutes after they got their first than it was that Pittsburgh would get a third. And just like that, they flipped the switch on 2 counter press created goals. They win the ball back in dangerous areas and quickly get into that transition to attack. And it's so challenging to defend a team like that when you've got the combination of an individual who can do what Mort just did, take a couple touches and crush a shot, or you're good, a cohesive unit that can create a goal.
Loffelson acrobatically weaving his way through the defense and cleared away by the Louisville back line, who are desperately trying to get another opportunity on the offensive third. It's not going to happen here. Pitt now with 4 goals in this match, have doubled their previous goal total in the previous 5 matches against Louisville.
Wow.
And it's not all that surprising though, Jeff, because Pitt have experienced rapid growth as a program over the last 4 or 5 seasons under Jay Vidovich. And they've gotten significantly better each year. And this year, we saw what happened in the exhibition match against Louisville. This is a high-powered attacking team that can find goals in bunches.
Well, it tells you a lot that a coach, as Jay Vidovich has been, more likely to talk about how much his team has improved in terms of feel and productivity and the way that they're playing performances than the raw numbers, which are they won 2 games in his first season, 8 in his second, 10 in his third, first ever NCAA tournament win. And then they turn around here and they're already at 5. They've already halved last season's totals and they're looking as good as anyone in the country. I mean, they're the number one team in the country. So this is performances matching results at this point.
There's a ball looking for Carlos Sanchez. I believe we'll have a corner kick for the Cards. Well, it's a throw in from Nico Diaz. Will be interesting to see what happens in the spring season for a lot of these clubs, particularly Pitt, who, you know, of course, are having such a great fall season. And they will have an opportunity to win the ACC tournament. But as far as an NCAA postseason goes, they'll have to wait until 2021.
It's just a weird season. I mean, just a weird, weird season to navigate, a weird school year to navigate. I was just talking to a professor at a local university here, Bellarmine University, about how their schedule is going. And they say, you just never know when we might get shut down and have to do something completely different. And it's applying to everything across the board and in athletics, especially at the college level where you've got students taking classes in addition to playing on teams. I mean, it is just so challenging for these coaches and players to navigate this. And it's tough when you're playing as well as you are when you're Pitt.
And of course, in 2021, you not only have to deal with the layoff, right, before returning for a spring season, but you also have the impending 2021 MLS draft.
Yep.
That could potentially shake up the roster of a team like Pitt with so many upperclassmen and so many guys who, in the words of Jay Vidovich, have a chance to play at the next level. Fall championship moved to the spring, as you see on your screen. The College Cup will be played in May, which doesn't seem quite right. Usually it's played
bizarre
in December.
Yeah.
So it'll be May 13th through the 17th. Selections on the 18th of April. And the big difference this year, too, is the field has shrunk to 36 teams, 24 automatic qualifiers, 12 at-large bids. And you would think Pitt would be a front runner to be an at-large qualifier, or a automatic qualifier, rather, out of the Atlantic Coast Conference.
You'd think so, yeah. And the talent level, like you said, they're going to have to try to keep that momentum going through the winter. It's going to be really difficult. It is resembling a little bit more of that European-style season. Maybe having the international roster with guys from France and Serbia and Switzerland might help them navigate this a little bit better. But who knows? It's going to be such an interesting way of playing this thing after being so familiar with a totally different format.
Crivillo plays it back for Luke Peperek. And Mirkovic rolls it back to the midfield for Bryce Washington. 4-1 in favor of the Pitt Panthers. 16 minutes away from their first victory over the Cards in the history of their program.
Shaping up to be one of those seasons for Pittsburgh. In their game notes, they've got milestones section that's already starting to fill up, and it just feels like it's going to keep adding bullet points to it for them as they continue to climb the ladder into their program's history, which is crazy to say they're only 5 games into the season, but that's where they are at this point. Some of these performances they've put together so far.
Free kick, Pittsburgh.
On the one hand, it's a shame that Pitt won't have a true full season to see what they can do in the postseason in the ACC tournament and then in the NCAA tournament. But on the other hand, it is a beautiful thing that we are playing soccer here in 2020 amidst everything that's going on. And John Michael Hayden said it well the other day. We're just happy to be on the field playing someone other than ourselves.
Yeah. I'm sure, and you get sick of each other. And these guys, something that comes up in conversations a lot, especially when people think that they can do just as well as a NFL kicker, or, you know, all these different ridiculous things you read on social media. These guys who reach this level of athletics are so competitive that they just want to get those juices flowing. They want to compete as much as possible whenever they can. And you get sick of playing your teammates. You want to be involved in stuff like this. You want to be able to play other teams that have become your rivals over the years. And you want to get out there and play. And COVID just put all of that into a big pile of uncertainty. And so I do think that having this chance to keep playing and play high-level opponents and get out there and try to grow as a team, especially if you're Louisville, is such a great opportunity. And certainly happy to be able to watch him play. Underrated part of this game, Matt. Both teams, great kits, great uniforms.
I love
both teams. I love the checker. I love the clean white look on for Pitt with the new script shield coming back from the old days. That checkerboard for Louisville, the black and red looking like the Croatian national team. It's a nice look for both teams.
Well, if you're going to play, you might as well look good doing it, right?
That's right. Look good, feel good.
Diaz. Carlos Sanchez in a battle with Walty. Somehow getting out of the corner, and he's got an opportunity to thread. Walty cutting him down. Louisville throw.
Oh. Of course, the downside as we pan out here and see the empty bleachers is that people can't enjoy this beautiful stadium put up a couple years ago, and it's just one of the nicest stadiums around. You have to think it's in that top echelon for college soccer stadiums, and just down the street is Lynn Family Stadium. Louisville City and the new NWSL team coming in 2021 here in Louisville, but two wonderful soccer stadiums in this city, and U of L does a really nice job filling it up when they have big games. It's disappointing to see it empty, but I think we all understand why. I'm just glad these guys are able to play in it.
Louisville more and more becoming a soccer town and a soccer hotbed. It's Louisville City having won a couple of USL championship titles right here in this stadium over the last few years. Now building, or completing, I should say, the new build across town.
Got an Eastern Conference final tomorrow night against Tampa Bay Rowdies, a chance to get back to another USL championship. So big weekend for soccer in Louisville, having the number one team in the country come and play on Friday, and then get that chance on Saturday night.
You can catch that game as well on ESPN digital platform, ESPN Plus.
Sure, Bradley Sample is disappointed that the ball kind of found his leg at a weird angle on that corner, but I think he's had a really nice game for Louisville overall. He's been around the ball, he's won it back a few times, he's been pretty confident in possession, shielding the back line. I know giving up four goals is not going to be something that anyone on U of L will be happy about, but I think Sample has had a really nice game for them in the center of the midfield.
Louisville team that have just been wrecked by this coronavirus situation. Injury, health, players not coming back due to the situation in the United States. And it especially early on left the team very low on personnel. And they've sort of been playing catch up ever since.
COVID kind of giveth and taketh away. I mean, the positive, if there is one, is you get Fonseca was able to stay, get fully healthy. We talked about that earlier in the season, about how much work he put in to stay healthy and stick around after missing out in last season. He's so talented, and you can just see it. He hasn't had the greatest games today just because obvious challenges, but the guy is just lightning quick. He looks so sharp on the ball, so creative. And that is probably, I can't say fully, but probably a huge benefit of him being able to stick around and work on everything through the offseason.
Booking will be coming from our central referee, Nick Balser. And it's given against Luis Lara, the freshman from Mexico City. He just checked in and already a booking. Been one of those days.
Well, Luis did not exactly give any reason to not get that yellow card. It's a pretty hard clattering in.
He's coming in to make his presence felt.
Absolutely.
At the end of this game.
You respect the opportunity to get in, get some run. Game, obviously, at this point is feeling like it's been iced for Pittsburgh. And if you're a team that's building the way they are into what they think is is going to be a team in the spring that can really make a run. You want to try to get as many reps as possible for your guys in games like this.
Pitt, again, another opportunity to put another goal on the sheet.
Substitution for Louisville. Number 18, Jack Hickey, replaces number 13.
So maybe visions of goal number two for Mort. I think that was him scuffing it with his left foot. Seeing glory, a chance to hit a second bullet into the top corner.
Jack Hickey coming on for the Louisville Cards. Redshirt sophomore from Richmond, Kentucky. He played his club soccer at Shattuck St. Mary's, which, if you're familiar with the prep soccer circuit in the United States, it's one of the best programs around the country, at least at the high school level. Tremendous athletics program at Shattuck St. Mary's, their hockey team. Always one of the top teams in the country as well. Difficult play there and done well. I believe that was Jack Fasteen on the far side getting it out of harm's way.
This is a sign of a team worthy of the number one ranking, a team that's confident in itself, that they were conceded, or that Pittsburgh conceded a goal, and they have just grown stronger as this half has gone on. I do think they felt maybe a little exposed after that first goal. Maybe there was a chance there, a loophole, that Louisville could maybe snag a second, but Pittsburgh has been dominant. And I'm sure that Jay Vidovich will be very happy that his team was able to carve out two more goals out of it and really put this thing out of reach.
Particularly after giving up that goal over the top to Elijah Amo, which, as you alluded to earlier, felt like it changed the dynamic of the match, at least momentarily. For five or 10 minutes, it seemed like Louisville was on the front foot and had an opportunity to potentially equalize. Pitt quickly closed the door on that, though, and have scored two more goals in this half. Louisville, of course, have been playing a man down since the 36th minute, and that certainly has significantly influenced the outcome of this match.
You just wonder, with when you're playing the style that Pitt plays, 11 on 11, it wears you down playing against it, but to have to do it when you only have 10 guys, you're just running that many more yards. It's just a lot of work, and as this game has worn on, you can tell that Pittsburgh has worn down Louisville a little bit.
Here's Anthony Harding, a late substitution. Crivillo now at the back. Pitt will go on to play Notre Dame in South Bend, Indiana next week, Friday before Halloween, before closing out its regular season against Syracuse on November the 6th. Both rematches, both wins for Pitt in the early goings of this season. Went into overtime against Notre Dame, winning that 3-2. And at the time, Notre Dame was ranked fifth in the country. If you're Louisville, how do you regroup for the final two games of the season? I mean, they've had the last three games, Jeff. The last three games, they've had at least one player sent off.
Well, yeah, that's where you start, is don't get anybody sent off. I think that's a big thing. And the red card today from Kamara, he's got to know better. And that's a learning experience. I'm sure they'll talk about it. and give it, it'll be a chance to really grow as a team and as a player, but you've got to first and foremost have everybody on the pitch for a game. You've got to be able to stay full personnel. I do think that they've shown some signs of organization in the back that's been decent. They've just got to seemingly get a little better in transition. It seems like if they lose the ball when they're flowing forward, as with most teams, it's easier to score on them. And I think that's how you grow as a team, is knowing exactly where you need to be, whose spot you need to be filling in for, because that guy has gone ahead in the attack when you're trying to recover from it. And it's just those little things that come with experience, that come with reps, that come with playing together. And it's just so hard, as we keep saying, when you're cobbling together a season and a roster that's really trying to grow with all the guys they lost from last season, it's difficult to do, but it can be done through a lot of hard work and just persistence.
Final 2 minutes of the match here in the Derby City. Here's Harding. And it's played back for Jackson Walty. ACC tournament will be played in November. And the conference will crown a tournament champion, which may be even more special in a season like this than winning the championship in the spring, just because the ACC has been so tough this year, like it usually is. And they've played a, well, closer to traditional fall season than most other conferences across the conference, across the country rather. So Pitt will improve to 5-0 with two more regular season games to go to get ready for the ACC tournament and lock up the number one seed out of their division. Louisville as well will have two more matches before the ACC tournament to try and make sure they are in that field. All but two teams will make it out of the ACC tournament this year.
7, 6, 5, 4, 3.
High scoring affair. Pitt with four goals, continuing on their average of 3.5 goals per game. It started early in the 8th minute on a corner kick from Velko Petkovic. Finds the back of the net off the foot of Bryce Washington. Then later, Filip Mirkovic. Hello! Back of the net on a rocket shot to make it 2-0 before halftime. Then a man down. Louisville's Elijah Amos sneaking in behind, and look at this pretty goal. You won't find a better one with the off foot. It looked for a second like Louisville might have a chance to equalize, but then this nifty goal here from Valentin Noel, and then the first goal of his career for Luke Mort, the redshirt freshman, weaving through traffic, upper nine, and a big celebration to cap off a 4-1 win